Hello students, welcome to FS Cloud. My name is Shashmita. We have an app by the name Careers Cloud which you can go and download through the Play Store. Once you have downloaded the application, you will be easily be able to log in using your Gmail ID. And once you have logged in, you will be redirected to this page where you will be getting this UI. And there will be option for Home, All Courses, My Courses and Browse section in this application. You will be getting multiple PDFs, multiple content on daily basis that will be enhancing your learning. Under Crack Current Affairs, you will be able to see multiple options. First one is Current Affairs English. We upload the day-to-day basis news in the English format. And apart from English PDF, we also provide them in Hindi format. And this Banking Awareness, we upload a PDF every month. So this PDF will contain the banking news, banking and the finance news of that respective month. And Current Affairs Exam PDF will have two categories. One is that most important news of that particular month will be uploaded in this Current Affairs Exam PDF. And also Exam Perspective PDF will also be uploaded. And next is Special CA. This will contain Union Budget, Economic Survey, and also the most important events that had taken place globally as well as nationally. And next most important is Topic Wise. So the entire news of that particular month will be segregated into different topics. And in order to recollect whatever you've read, we also provide you with Topic Wise quizzes. Apart from that, we also provide State Current Affairs. Now, here if you see, we provide you with the day-to-day PDF, and this we provide you with the weekly PDF. So that particular week news will be compiled into a PDF and in question and answer format in English and will be uploaded here. And to enhance your learning, you can also, to enhance and strengthen your learning, you can also attend the quiz. Here we provide you with the entire news of that particular week. But here we take the top 60 most important news and we upload it in this PDF in question and answer format. Apart from weekly, we also provide you the monthly ones. This PDF will contain detailed view of that particular month news. And this will have a brief format of the same news. This will be in the form of a question and answer format. And this will have the top 100 question and answer of that particular month. We also provide you with the PIB news on a day-to-day basis, which you can go and read in these particular tabs. Apart from that, we also provide the Union Budget and Economic Survey. You can also attend the, you can read, after reading the PDF, you can also go and attend the quiz. This is available in the Special CA category. We also provide state level current affairs. So this will be very helpful for students who are preparing for state level exams. For example, if you are preparing for Tamil Nadu state level exams, then you can click this tab and you will be able to see all the current affairs or news related to Tamil Nadu. Apart from that, we also provide PDF from the exam perspective. Suppose you are preparing for RBI Assistant Mains, then this tab will contain 5 to 6 months of current affairs, which has high probability of being asked in RBI Assistant Mains. Similarly for SBI PO, RRB PO, Clerk Mains, all these are being given under this section. And also we provide separate content-wise, topic-wise current affairs like national affairs, government schemes, international affairs, banking and finance, economy and businesses, MOUs and committees and meetings. All these different types of news are segregated in these particular categories. Hello students, welcome to our new initiative. In this initiative, we will be uploading the weekly current affairs on banking and finance section. So this will be uploaded on every Monday. And so on the whole, per month, you will have totally 4 videos related to this topic. And apart from just providing you with the banking and finance news, we also provide you the conceptual explanation so that this will enhance and also strengthen your knowledge about these topics. Today, we will be covering the May 4th week banking and finance awareness news. Moving to the first news, RBI has launched 3 new initiatives. So let us see them one by one. The first is that platform for regulatory application validation and authorization called Prava Portal. Second one is RBI Direct, Retail Direct mobile application. And the last one is a FinTech repository. So this Prava Portal will enable the entities who wants to apply for license for banking or non-banking companies, they or payment aggregator, they can apply via this portal. So if you see, it is a centralized, secure, web-based platform that will allow individuals or entities to apply online for approvals, license and authorization from the RBI. So after applying, you can track the application in this portal and also you can receive, you can see whether you have received the RBI decision in a time-bound manner in this portal. The second one is the RBI Retail Direct mobile application. In the previous meeting, the governor has said that they plan to introduce an application and mobile app for investors, that is the individual investors, to buy government securities from the government. So if you see, in November 2021, RBI had launched the Retail Direct Gilt account. So it has launched a scheme called RBI Retail Direct scheme. So mostly until then, it was the institutional buyers or the banks or the insurance companies, mostly the investors of government securities. So they wanted the individual participants, individual persons to invest in this government securities. So for that reason, this portal was launched. So this RBI Retail Direct scheme was launched so that individual people can come and invest in government securities, both in the primary market as well as in the secondary market. So in the primary market, under the non-competitive scheme, they can buy the government securities from the RBI. Next, in the secondary market, they can buy and sell the government securities on the negotiated dealing system. Just like you have the stock exchange to sell your stocks or shares, similarly, to sell the government securities or buy the government securities in the secondary market, you have to be in the negotiating dealing system. So in the negotiating dealing system, you can buy and sell the government securities. So until now, you have to the online portal from where you can open this Retail Direct Gilt account, just like you have this DMAT account where all the shares are stored. Similarly, government securities are stored in this Retail Direct Gilt account. So to open this, you had to go and visit this portal. Now to make it even more convenient, the RBI has launched a mobile application. So this app will facilitate seamless and convenient access to retail investors to buy and sell government securities directly from their smartphone. So it simplifies the transaction both in primary market and the secondary market. Now, the third initiative is FinTech Repository. It is nothing but it contains the entire information about the regulated and non-regulated. So both the FinTech companies, entire activities, their activities, their technology application, all this will be present in this repository. So this would serve as a compendium for the policy makers. So this will help them understand the sector even more, so that this will help in the specific policy making for that specific sector. So that is the purpose of this repository. Another repository is that MTech repository. This is only for the RBI regulated entities, that is banking and non-banking financial companies. So here it will track their adoption of the emerging technologies. So now if you see, a lot of cyber attacks are taking place. So it is very important for the bank to update their IT system. So for that purpose, to track their adoption technology like artificial intelligence, machine language, this MTech repository is being introduced. So both these repositories are managed by the RBI IH, that is the Reserve Bank Innovation Hub. This is the youngest subsidiary of the RBI. Now, next news is that IRDAI introduces new corporate governance regulation for the insurers. Now, so these new regulation issued through the master circular, it becomes effective upon issuance. So once the circular is issued, immediately it will be effective. But however, the insurers have given time up to 30th June 2024 to ensure the compliance with this provision. So this master circular will be applicable to all insurers except for the foreign companies engaged in the reinsurance business. So what is reinsurance? Now there is a bank A. Now it has given insurance to the depositors. It collects the money from the depositors. Now this will be insured by an insurance. So if at all the bank fails to pay, then the insurance company will pay the depositor. Now if there are a lot of customers, if the deposit in the bank is too heavy, that insurance might fear, what if I am not able to pay to the depositors? So for that purpose, it will again reinsure its insurance. So this is called as reinsurance, insuring the insurance again in order to reduce the risk. So this is called as the reinsurance. Now, so what are the provisions? So these are the following provisions that they have to follow by June 2024. That is, they have to have mandatory insurance companies to seek prior approval for their board chairperson appointments with immediate effect. So before appointing a board chairperson, you have to get prior approval from the IRDAI. And if the existing chairpersons, they have given time until 31st March 2026, end of their current terms, whichever comes first, to comply with the new norms. So for existing, this is the condition, and if you want to appoint new persons, then you have to get prior approval from the IRDAI. Apart from that, insurers is now mandated to ensure an optimum composition of independent director and non-executive director in the board of directors. So there should be at least three minimum independent directors. Now, if you see, there are mainly two types of directors. One is the executive director and another one is a non-executive director. This executive director will be involved in the day-to-day activities of the company. But non-executive director, he will not be involved in the day-to-day activities. He will only mostly be involved in the policy making, or he will be there to challenge the decisions taken by the executive director. So this was the main thing of the non-executive director, but he will not be involved in the day-to-day activities of the company. And he is a full-time director. Executive director is a full-time director. And under non-executive director, you have a category called independent director. So they do not have a relationship with the company such that their decision will be influenced. So whatever judgment that an independent director takes, it's completely not influenced by the company. And independent director, they mostly try to ensure that the corporate governance, the governance standard is maintained in the company. So this is the job of the independent director. So there are two types, executive and non-executive, and under non-executive, independent director is one type. So they have to ensure that there is at least three independent directors in the composition, board of directors. Now, if a board of meeting takes place, then it can be considered valid only if at least one third of the total strength of the board or three directors, whichever is higher, is present. Only if these many people are present, only then the board of meeting will be considered a valid one. Next is that there should at least be one woman director on the board of every insurance company as required under the section 149 of the Companies Act 2013. And the last one is that insurers shall put in place a whistleblower policy. So if anyone in the company, may I say even a managing director, if he goes against the rules of the company, then an employee can go and inform that this person is not following the rules. He is going against the ethics of the company, or he is going against the rules of the company. He can go and inform. That is called as the whistleblower policy. But this whistleblower policy should be framed in a very nice and a good manner, because it should also protect the employee who has complained against the management. So mostly they will complain anonymously. So the whistleblower policy should be such that it should protect the people who complains against the management or against the people who are not following the rules. So where employees would be able to raise their concerns at company internal forum regarding possible irregularities, governance or financial reporting. Next is that IRDAI introduced flexibility in procedural norms on expense of management share transfer. Now, if you see, there is an insurance company A. So, it will sell its insurance policies to various customer X1, X2, X3. Now, how will it sell the insurance policies to this customer? There will be one intermediary called as the insurance agent. So he will go and explain the policies to the customer, and he will sell the customers from the insurance company. So how will he earn the money? He will earn the money using commission. So with the number of policies he sells, for each policy he will have a commission to it. So what it has, IRDA has told that the commission structure shall be reasonable and not result in excessive compensation for the intermediaries at the expense of the customer or the insurers. And this commission structure will only be applicable for the new upcoming policies and not for the policy that has already been sold. So IRDA, apart from that, it has also simplified the various application procedures, employee stock option plans, and also the share transfer plans. So all these procedures have been simplified by the IRDA. Next news is that unclaimed deposits in banks, they have reached around 42,270 crore as of March 2023 as per the data released by RBI. So, the public sector banks, if you see, it holds around 33,303 crore, which is 83% of the total. Now, first, what is this unclaimed deposit? See, if there is a customer, he has opened account in some bank, ABC. And for around 10 years, he was not operating the account. The account remained inactive for around 10 years. Then, that account will be called as inactive account, and the amount in that account will be transferred to a DEF account of the RBI. So this DEF, whatever amount is there in the DEF account, those are called as unclaimed deposits. So if at all after 11 years, like 10th year, suppose in the 11th year, If the customer comes and tells, I want this money, then he can go and tell the branch, and the branch can process the money, get back the money from the DEF account, and then send it to the customer account. So the purpose of this is that when an account is inactive, not operated for around 10 years, then after 10 years, the deposit of that in that account will be transferred to the DEF account managed by RBI, and that those accounts are called as unclaimed deposits. Now, so if you see the public sector banks, they hold 33,300 crore, that is 83% of the total, and it is the highest in State Bank of India with 2.16 crore accounts worth rupees 8,069 crore, and followed by Punjab National Bank. Similarly, in case of private sector banks, it is the highest in ICICI Bank with 31 lakh accounts worth rupees 1,074 crores. And if you see in foreign bank, the DBS Bank has increased the unclaimed deposits from 0.5 crore in 2019 to 94 crore in 2022. So these are nothing but the inactive accounts for 10 years. They are transferred, the amount in that inactive account is transferred to the DEF account maintained by the RBI, and the RBI now it has recently launched Udgam portal called Unclaimed Deposits Gateway to Access Information. So here all the inactive accounts will be listed, and so that this will help the customers to claim their money in a quite convenient way. So this is a centralized search of the unclaimed deposits. As of March 2024, there are 30 banks which has participated in the Udgam portal. Now, please mention in the comment section the full form of DEF. Now, next news is that SEBI mandates social enterprises on social stock exchange to submit annual impact report for financial year 2024. Now, if a company A wants to raise money from the public, then it will get listed in the stock exchange and raise money from the people. Similarly, there is a non-profit organization. So non-profit organization, they are the company, they work for the welfare of the society. They do not, the profit is not their aim, but the welfare of the society is their aim. So they work for the society. So there will be a lot of non-profit organization who may not have the money. So for them to raise money from the common people, this stock exchange, social stock exchange, was launched. So in this social stock exchange, a non-profit organization can raise the money from the public. For this purpose, this social stock exchange has launched, but many people started misusing this social stock exchange. So they will register themselves as non-profit organization just to raise money from the public and not to do any welfare activity. So for this purpose, SEBI has mandated that they should have an annual impact report. They should have proper audits so that there is no malpractices happening. Now, SEBI has instructed the social enterprises who have registered or raised funds through the social stock exchange to submit an annual impact report for the financial year 23-24 to the exchange by the end of October 2024. So using that money, they would have raised and they would have made some, they would have done some social activities, right? So for that, they have to create an annual impact report and produce it to the SEBI by October 2024. So for this purpose, the SEBI has appointed two additional agencies, that is ICMAI, Social Auditors Organization, and ICSI, Institute of Social Auditors. They will be acting as a self-regulatory organization to assess the societal impacts of the social activities carried out by the social enterprises. So annual impact report will be prepared by the social enterprises only. So they can just tell that I have created this road, I have planted these many trees, and all, they can just write the data. But whether it's true or not, whether they have actually done, if they have actually done, has it impacted the society or not? So for that purpose, these two agencies are appointed and they have to assess the impact of the social activities. Now, if you see a social stock exchange, it is a platform which is different from the existing stock exchange that help the non-profit organization and for-profit social enterprises to raise funds from the capital market. So not only non-profit organization, but also for the profit social enterprises. So they are for profit, but they want to create some social welfare activities. They can also raise funds from this social stock exchange. Now, government set to launch new national portal NHCX to simplify health insurance claim. If you want, suppose you have been admitted in the hospital and you have an insurance. After, now if you want to claim the insurance, then you have to go and visit the particular insurance company's website and then submit all the bills, and then your amount will be claimed. But now what government has planned to do, that there will be one common portal where all the insurers, the hospitals, the customer, all these three people will meet in this one single portal, and they can claim the money, whatever the bill amount is, they can claim from this portal. So the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare is set to launch a unified portal named National Health Claim Exchange to simplify the process of filing health insurance claim. So the NHCX is developed by National Health Authority. It has been developed under the Ayushman Bharat Digital Mission. So this was developed in 2021. So here all the, you will have Ayushman Bharat health account, which is a 14 digit number. The customers will have, so that the customers can store their health records digitally in via this Ayushman Bharat Digital Mission. This was the main purpose of this Ayushman Bharat Digital Mission. Similarly, under this, this NHCX will be developed. So this will be a single window platform between health insurance company, hospitals and insurance policy holders. It will facilitate easier and faster health insurance claim settlement. So this is the purpose of the platform. So similarly, apart from that, a lot of initiatives have been done by IRDAI recently. If you see, from April 1st, IRDAI has stated that the policies have to be issued only in the electronic form, and all the policies of a particular person can be stored in an account called e-insurance account. So if we have three different policies for health, for vehicle, and also term insurance, all this can be stored in one account called the e-insurance account. So one e-insurance account will be created for a person, and all the policies can be stored in this one account. And also it has created Bima Sugam portal. It is a marketplace for insurance to help policy holders compare the premium and the features of all categories of insurance products. So he can compare the all the features and premiums and choose the best product for him from this Bima Sugam market. We have launched a new course called Static Banking Awareness Course. Now this course will be helpful for students who are preparing for the banking exams and for the regulatory body exams. And also, recently you would have seen Paytm Bank in news frequently. So when an aspirant reads this news, he would have ample number of questions like, what is a payment bank, what are the norms for it, and which is the committee that has launched it. So this Static Banking Awareness Course lays a foundation to the current banking and finance news. Now you have to download our Careers Cloud to access this course. Once you have logged into our app, you can go and click this all courses icon, and then you'll be redirected to this page. In this, you have to go and click the Static Banking Awareness Course, and under the details tab you will be able to see a brief about this course. And under the part tab, it will contain all the contents, all the topics of the contents that are currently available in this course. We are working on this continuously, and this will be completed within 2 months. Under the free tab, you can go and access one content, that is the origin and development content, for free. You can go and read this content and have an idea about this course. After reading this content, do attend the quiz that is also available under the same tab. Now, our team has allocated ample amount of time and resources to curate this content. We have created this content from various books and from various verified websites. Our content is better than any book that is available in the market. This is because we update this content on a dynamic basis. For example, there are currently 39 DRTs that are available in the country now. In future, if one more DRT is created or added, then it would become 40. So we would update this content on a dynamic basis. But in case of books, you have to wait for the next publication for this updated content. Nowadays, a lot of practical questions have been asked in the banking exams. For example, how many public sector banks are available on the stock exchange? Which is the payment bank that has been listed on the stock exchange? So we try to cover as many practical questions as possible in this course. Apart from this, we also provide you a question bank that will contain around 3000 questions and the previous year questions along with it. We also have a dedicated tab that will release the important RBI notification and the frequent news released by the RBI. You can use this code B15 to avail 15% discount. This is one of the highest discounts that we have offered until now. So do avail this code B15 while you purchase the course. The next news is about a framework released by SEBI. So SEBI has notified a framework for issuance of subordinate units in privately placed InvIT. So InvIT is Infrastructure Investment Trust. So they are somewhat similar to mutual funds. So they collect money from the investors or people, institutional buyers, and invest in infrastructure projects. There is a sponsor involved in this InvIT. So they will hold a minimum threshold, minimum value in this InvIT of around 15%. So in the total issuance of InvIT, the sponsor will hold at least minimum 15% of the InvIT issuance. Now, if you see, mostly in the current scenario, the InvIT structures, it has been observed that it is primarily the sponsor or its group who monetize their infrastructure assets and are primarily the sellers of the infrastructure assets to the InvIT. So you know that InvIT, they invest in infrastructures. So here, mostly in India, what happens is that the sponsors, they sell the infrastructure to the InvIT and InvIT invests in that infrastructure. So that is how it is happening mostly in India. Now, what is the framework is all about? Consider. So there is an InvIT XYZ. So it is telling that it is planning to invest in an infrastructure asset from sponsor A. So there is a sponsor A. It is planning to sell its infrastructure project to the InvIT XYZ. Now this sponsor A is telling that this project will grow at a rate of 10%. We know that infrastructure project, they do have an appreciation every year. So this sponsor A, which is selling the infrastructure, it is telling that my infrastructure, it will grow at the rate of 10% per annum. So I am telling that the value of this infrastructure will be 1000 crores. But what is this XYZ company selling? That it is evaluating and it is finding out that no, it will not grow at 10% per annum. It will only grow at 9% per annum. So I am valuing it at only at 900 crores. So if you see, there is a difference of 100 crores of valuation between these two. So this 100 crores can now be issued as a subordinate bonds. So they can be issued as a subordinate units and sold it to the sponsor. So if you see, it may take in such a case, the sponsor may get 900 crores in form of cash or ordinary units or a combination of both, and may take the subordinate units worth of rupees 100 crores, that is the difference in valuation assessed by the sponsor and the InvIT. So if you see that the terms and the conditions of issuance of subordinate bonds will provide that the subordinate units, it can be classified at to ordinary units. So this subordinate units, it can be classified as ordinary units at the end of 5 years of the InvIT. So they have to achieve. So after this 10% per annum is achieved, then the InvIT can classify it as ordinary units. So until then, it will only be classified as subordinate units. So basically, what is the use of the subordinate units? When there is a difference in the valuation assessed by the sponsor and the InvIT, then the difference in valuation can be issued as subordinate units to the sponsor. Then afterwards, when this difference is reached, is performed, then this subordinate units can be converted into ordinary units and sold to the public or to the other investors. So until then, if you see, subordinate units, they don't have distribution rights and voting rights. So the general other units, ordinary units, will have distribution rights and voting rights, but this subordinate unit will not have any distribution or voting rights. So now, what are the other features of subordinate units? So subordinate units shall be issued by a privately placed InvIT only. So you can place the InvIT even on a public exchange. So they can be distributed to the public people. When it is distributed to the investors, then it's called as a public placed. But here, private placed, only a little group of people. So the investors who are QIB, like qualified institutional buyers. So they have complex knowledge about this. So they can take a lot of risk. So this is called as a privately placed. So only in privately placed InvIT, you can issue this subordinate units. Subordinate units, and it should be issued only to the sponsor, its associates, and the sponsor group. These units should not be issued to anyone else other than the sponsor associates and the sponsor group. And also, InvIT will not raise funds to the public issue if any subordinate units are outstanding. So only after clearing the subordinate units, the InvIT can raise funds from the public. And also, the subordinate units shall not carry any voting rights or distribution rights as we discussed in the previous slide. Now, the amount of subordinate units at the time of acquisition, it shall not exceed 10% of the acquisition price of the infrastructure. Say the acquisition price of the infrastructure is 1000 crores, then 10% of it should not be more than that. So that is what is said about the subordinate units. And also at any point of time, it should not exceed 10% of the total number of outstanding ordinary units issued by such. So there will be an ordinary, suppose there are 100 ordinary units issued, then only 10 units, subordinate units should be issued. Not more than 10 subordinate units should be issued. This is what this point tells. Now subordinate units will be reclassified into ordinary units when they achieve the performance benchmark after 3 years of issuance. So as we saw in the previous slide, subordinates can be converted into ordinary after the performance benchmark has been achieved, that is after 3 years. So it takes 3 years, and only after that this can be converted into an ordinary units. Then the investment manager is required to obtain in principle approval from the recognized stock exchange for listing of such subordinate units. Next news is that SEBI amends framework for the dynamic price band for scrips in derivative segments. Now, what is this dynamic price band? Dynamic price bands, they are limits set on how much the price of a stock or a derivative can move within a trading day. See, suppose previous day the closing price of the stock was 100 rupees. Then you know that the trading time is from 9:15 to 3:30. So in this time, this price of the stock may increase or decrease. So this dynamic price band, it sets up a band. It sets a range within which the price can go up and down. Suppose if it's going to go down up to 50 rupees, then it will be a loss to a lot of investors. It is a very risky case. So in that case, so to avoid and also to protect the investors, this dynamic price band has been set. So currently, if you see, these bands will help prevent extreme volatility and ensure orderly trading. So for stocks with derivative products, the band starts at 10% of the previous day's closing price. So suppose the previous day's closing price was 100, the next day it can go up to 110 or it can go down up to 90 rupees. So this is the price band within which it can swing. Now, these price bands can be flexed by 5% of yesterday's closing price during the day as many times as required. Now, what is this flexing? We'll see it in the next page. Now, flexing means when the market price or the last traded price approaches the upper or the lower band, then a relaxation happens. Once relaxation takes place, the member can place orders in the particular security at the prices up to the revised lower or the upper band. So the relaxation of this operating range of contract is known as flexing. See, let me explain with you the example. So in the previous case, you saw that 100 rupees was the previously traded price. So the next day it can go from 90 to 110. Now, suppose the stock has reached this price. Now it has been trading at 110. Now, since it has reached the upper band, you can again relax it. And maybe you can increase it to let now the upper band be 115 and the lower band be 95. So this relaxation is known as the flexing. Now, there are certain conditions you have to follow before doing this flexing. Now, let us see what is it. So if you see the previous norms, flexing of price bands required 25 trades from at least 5 unique client codes. So each client will have a separate code. Each investor will have a separate code. So you have to have at least 25 trades from at least 5 unique client codes on each side of the trade when the price moved 9.9 or more. Now, if you see, as I said, it was 100. So when it has reached the 110, then at least 25 trades from 5 unique client code and on each side of the trade, which means buy and sell. On both the sides, this has to be taken place, and then only this flexing can happen. and that too it can happen only by 5%. That was how it was there for the previous month. 5%, which means, so now it is 10% of the previous day. Now the flexing can be 15% of the previous day. Similarly, again, this condition, again, if this condition after some time it has been increased to 115. And if you see again, the upper band, again, the price, the share prices are have reached the upper band, that is 115. Then if this, again, they'll check this condition. If this condition is satisfied, then it can increase to 20%, a 5% increase from the last traded price. So it can increase to 120. The upper band can increase to 120. So previously it was 100 in the previous day, and then by dynamic price range, it got increased to 110, and by flexing, it got increased to 115. And again, since it had reached the upper band, another flexing took place and it got reached to 120. So this is the process of flexing. Now they have changed the norms for flexing. Now they have, as per the new norms, flexing now requires 50 trades from at least 10 UCC and 3 members on each side. So previously it was 25 trades, now it is 50, and previously it was 5 UCC and now it is 10 UCC. So this is the new norms for flexing to happen. So if you see, this is say if 25 trades from 5 different UCCs on each side occurred or above 9.9, then the dynamic price band is flexed to 15%. Again, if 25 trades from 5 different UCC occurs, then the price band will again change to 20%, from 15 to 20%. So this is what I have explained with this example. Now, and also there is a cooling period. So before a flexing happen or after a flexing happens, there will be a cooling period of 15 minutes. So it has been decided that the cooling off period of 15 minutes would be increased and the flexing percent of 5% would be decreased. So this is another change. So as of now, the cooling period is 15 minutes and the flexing percentage, if you see, it is 5% from the last trading price, previously traded price. So they have planned to increase the cooling period and decrease the flexing. Let us see. So if you see, for the first two instances of flexing, the price band would be flexed by 5% of yesterday's closing price after the cooling off period. This cooling off period would be 15 minutes if conditions for flexing are satisfied before last half an hour of the trading. So we know the trading window is 9:15 to 3:30. So if this flexing condition is satisfied before 3 o'clock, then the cooling period will be 15 minutes. But if the flexing condition is satisfied after 3 o'clock, then the cooling period will be 5 minutes. So this is what has been stated, but the flexing percentage remains the same, that is only 5%. Next case is that for the first two instances of the day, it will be 5%. And for the subsequent two instances, it has stated that price band would be flexed by 3% of yesterday's closing price after the cooling period of 30 minutes. So first two instances, it is 5% and 15 minutes cooling period if it happens before 3 o'clock, and if it happens in the last half an hour of the trading period, then the cooling period will be 5 minutes, but still the percentage remains the same, 5%. After the two instances happen, the third instance, if you see, the flexing percentage has decreased to 3% and the cooling period has increased to 30 minutes. Similarly, for subsequent instances of flexing, the price band of the flexing has decreased further to 2%. And the time period, that is the cooling period, has increased to 60 minutes. So 5%, 15 minutes, 3%, 30 minutes, 2% and 60 minutes. This is the new change that I have bought. So the circular would be implemented by the stock exchange in a phased manner starting from June 3, 2024. Now, so next is that NSE lowered the tick size to 1 paisa for stock price below 250. Like, before understanding this tick size, let me give you an example. You know that treasury bills, we just saw in the first news that treasury bills can be bought by individual investors, by banks, by insurance company, many people, right? So the minimum value of the treasury bill is 10,000. So you can buy only in the multiples of 10,000. So that is, you cannot buy for 11,000 or 12,000. So you can either buy for 10,000, next is 20. And similarly, 30, 40, 50, like that it goes. So this is how the treasury bills can be bought. So just keep this example in mind and we'll go to the next slide. So if you see the tick size, it is the minimum price increment between two consecutive bid and offer prices. So if you see, for example, if a stock size has the tick size of rupees 10 paisa and the last traded price was 200, then the next possible price can be 199.90, 199.80. It cannot be 199.80, just like the previous example, it can be 10,000 or 20,000, but not 25 or 24,000. Similarly, this cannot be 199.86 and all if the tick size is 10 paisa. So if the, because it does not meet the tick size requirement. So the National Stock Exchange, it has announced that it has lowered the tick size for all stocks from 5 paisa to 1 paisa for securities below 250. So for the stocks which are trading below 250, for them the tick size has been reduced from 5 paisa to 1 paisa. The new tick size will be effective from 10th June 2024 and the stock futures shall have the same tick size from 8 July. So, you know, there are various options like futures and options. These are all like derivatives of the stocks. So, this stocks and futures, they are a derivative of the stock that is trading in the cash segment. So, when there is a change in this tick size for the stock, similarly, there will be a change in the future of that stock also. There will be a change in the tick size. So, the first, it will be implemented for the stocks in 10th June and for the futures, it will be implemented from the 8th July 2024. So the new tick size will be applicable to all securities except exchange traded funds. The tick size for T plus 1 settlement securities will also be applicable to T plus 0. T plus 1 and T plus 2 is the settlement time. So for both the securities that are that can be settled in T plus 1 and T plus 0, for both the tick size will be applicable. The new tick size of NSE is more competitive with Bombay Exchange. If you see the Bombay Stock Exchange, it had implemented this tick size in March 2023 itself, but it is for stocks below 100. And now the National Stock Exchange, it is implementing this 1 paisa tick size for stocks below 250. And Bombay Stock Exchange, it had implemented for stocks below 100.
The next news is about a new framework released by SEBI regarding to determine the unaffected price in response to market rumor. The SEBI has introduced a new framework for considering unaffected price for transaction after the confirmation of the market rumors. Now, the market rumors can be anything related to the exiting of the top management, cancellation of order or the financial health. Anything can be market rumor to arrest the price variation due to this rumors. For this purpose, the framework has been introduced. If you see, the framework stated that if the rumor related to any entity has been released and a price fluctuation has seen, then if the company confirms the rumor within 24 hours of the event or the information being out in the mainstream media, suppose a rumor has been released today. And if you see the next day morning itself, there is a price fluctuation. Price variation due to this rumor. So, if the company confirms the rumor within 24 hours of the price fluctuation or if the media or from the information available on the media. So, if the information is available on the same day from here 24 hours. So, T plus 2 day, it has to confirm the rumor. Then the ensuing change, that is ensuing change means the price variation due to this news in the stock price will not be factored to ascertain the pricing for many things like preferential issue of shares, takeover, buyback, delisting or any fundraising activities. This variation due to the rumors will not be included. Now let us see this with an example. See, this is the average price being traded. Okay, so this is the price and if you see the date of price, material price movement. So there has been a rumor something on 26 July night and then the next day morning there has been a price movement. So it is 1164. So if you see the price movement is 1164, that is the date of material price movement. Then the next day the company confirms the rumor, that day the price of the movement is 1173. So in this case, if the company confirms the rumor within 24 hours, then the price before the material price movement day. So this day is the price movement day and the price before this day will be considered as the adjusted daily weighted average price.
So if you see, this is the way, this day is the price movement, and the previous day it was 1060. So this price will be considered for the day when the price movement have occurred and the day when the rumor confirmation has been made by the company, and also the next day after the rumor confirmation. For these 3 days, the previous day price will be considered. So this is the new thing that SEBI has bought into. And also, till this unaffected price will be calculated up to the day the board announces the news. So it is up to the relevant date. So if you see the, in this case, the in this example, the relevant date is about the date of board approval to preferential issue to QIB. So up to this date, this unaffected price will be calculated. Now, how is this 1055 price is calculated? This is nothing but the difference between 1178 and this. So it is 1178 minus the 1060, the adjusted daily weighted average price, that is around 118. So this 118 will be subtracted from this, from this, from this, and from the daily WAP price to get the adjusted daily WAP. So the variation, this 118, is obtained from the previous day by subtracting the daily WAP and the adjusted daily WAP, and that that variation is subtracted from each daily WAP till the relevant day. So this is the framework that SEBI has brought. Now, if you see, the unaffected price shall be applicable for a period of 60 days or 180 days as applicable based on the stage of transaction from the date of confirmation of the market rumor till the relevant day. So we saw that this unaffected price 118, it was applicable. We have subtracted this 118 to get the unaffected price from the rumor confirmation till the relevant day. So these many days we have subtracted the variation to get the unaffected price. So here it has stated that it is applicable for 60 days or 180 days. So as per this second provision of regulation of the LODR regulation, if a rumor pertaining to a transaction has been verified within 24 hours of the trigger of a material price movement, then the unaffected price will be taken into consideration for transaction on which the pricing norms specified by the SEBI or stock exchange are applicable. So if within 24 hours the rumor confirmation has been made, then the unaffected price will be taken into consideration by the SEBI and the stock exchange. So this framework will be applicable to the top 100 listed entities with effect from 1st June 2024 and then to the top 250 listed entities from 1st December 2024. I hope this is clear. So first, you have to confirm the rumors within 24 hours, and then after that, for 3 days, it will be applicable. That is the price movement date, the rumor confirmation date, and also the next day after the rumor confirmation has been made. And then the unaffected price will be calculated by calculating the difference between the weighted average price and the adjusted weighted average price. Adjusted weighted average price. So this amount, this variation, will be subtracted from every day's weighted average price to get the unaffected price till the relevant date. So the relevant date can be 60 days or 180 days from the rumor confirmation date. Moving to the next news. SEBI amends rule to facilitate ease of doing for companies planning IPOs. So if you see, to ease the process of companies which are planning to go for IPOs, the SEBI has issued this regulation. So to facilitate ease of doing business for companies planning IPOs, SEBI has said that any change in the size of offer of sale requiring fresh filing will be based on only one of the criteria, either issue size in rupees or the number of shares. So we know that after going for IPO, IPO is the initial public offer. So when the company wants to raise money from the public for the first time, then that term is called as IPO. And after raising, if they want further money from the public, then they can go for offer for sale. So here, basically, the promoter's share are diluted. So promoters, they sell their shares to the public to raise the money. So in this case, if you want to calculate the filing of the offer of sale, then it can be based on either issue size in rupee or the number of shares that has been sold in the offer of sale. Next, companies promoted by the entrepreneurs, they often have several rounds. So if you see, if before the company gets into the public stock exchange, they will do a lot of funding prior to that. So before listing the equities on the stock exchange, in such situation itself, if you see, the promoter's shareholding will reduce. So initially a promoter will hold 100% of a company, and if they start raising funding in a private funding round before the stock exchange, obviously the promoter shareholding is going to get reduced. So in that case, if you see, in such situation, the promoter shareholding may fall short of 20% of the post offer equity share. So as per the existing norms, after the equity share has been established on the stock exchange, the promoter should hold at least 20% of the post offer equity share. But due to this previous rounds of funding, there may be cases where the promoter can hold below 20% of the post offer equity share capital. So in that case, it has permitted certain categories of investors to contribute equity shares held by them towards the shortfall. So before the stock exchange, listing on the stock exchange, they raise money through various funding. In this itself, there are cases where the promoter shareholding can go from 100% to 15%. But if you want to get listed on the stock exchange, the promoter should hold minimum 20% of the post offer equity share capital. So if this 5% difference is there, 5% shortage is there, then there are certain category of investors who can contribute their equity shares towards this shortfall. So a flexibility has been provided in this framework, in this procedure. Now if you see, the promoter group entities and the non-individual shareholders holding more than 5% of the post offer equity share capital, it can be permitted to contribute towards the shortfall in the minimum promoter's contribution. So this 5%, it can be contributed by the promoter group entity or the non-individual shareholders who are holding more than 5%. So if you see, from 100 it has gone to 15%, right? So the 85% would have been sold to a lot of people. They can be non-individual shareholders too. So if they hold more than 5%, then they can contribute to this minimum promoter holding contribution without being identified as promoter. So they don't have to be identified as promoter, and they can contribute to the shortfall. Now, adjustment for force majeure event. Force majeure is like any God event or any event which cannot be blamed by any party. This is called as force majeure events. So the bid closing day, it can be extended by a minimum of 1 day due to the force majeure events such as banking strikes and all, instead of the previous requirement of 3 days. So previously, if you see, it was 3 days, and now it has been extended by a minimum of 1 day due to the force majeure events. In addition, equity shares from the conversion of the compulsory convertible securities held for a year before filing the draft red herring prospects are to be considered for meeting the minimum promoter shareholding requirements. So if you see, there are certain bonds that are issued. Generally, when the bonds are issued, they can be redeemed on the expiry date. So whenever the bond expires, that time you can give the bond and you can collect the bond from the bond. You can collect the money from the bond issuer. But there are certain bonds that cannot be collected as money, that cannot be redeemed as money, but only can be redeemed as convertible securities. So there will be certain conditions by selling the bond itself. So by selling this bond itself, there will be that you cannot redeem this for money. You can only redeem this as convertible securities. So what will happen that on the day of expiry, the buyer of the bond will sell the bond, will sell back the bond, will give the bond to the seller, and the seller of the bond will tell, I cannot give you money, because the condition itself while selling the bond is that I can give you only in securities in exchange, that is the shares of the company. So on the expiry date, the buyer of the bond will sell the bond, will give the bond to the seller, and the seller will not give the money but will give the securities in exchange. This is called as compulsory convertible securities. So if you see, if the compulsory convertible securities, they are held for a year before filing the draft red herring prospectus. So before going for an IPO, you have to file this red herring prospectus with the stock exchange. So before, if you hold this securities, convertible securities, for 1 year before filing this draft red herring prospectus, then this can be considered for meeting the minimum promoter shareholding. So these measures, they aim to streamline the IPO process and provide greater flexibility for the companies and the promoters. The next news is about an appointment former cabinet secretary Pradeep Kumar Sinha appointed as the non-executive part-time chairman of ICICI Bank. So he will succeed Girish Chandra Chaturvedi, who is set to retire on 30th June 2024. Apart from this, Pradeep Kumar Sinha is also been approved as an additional independent director by the board of directors of ICICI Bank for a 5-year term period, that is from 2024 to 2029. His previous work history is that he has served as a cabinet secretary and also as a principal advisor to the prime minister, and also he has served as an additional independent director in Bharti Airtel Limited. The MD and CEO of ICICI Bank is Sandeep Bakshi. It is headquartered in Mumbai and it was established in 1994. Goldman Sachs has revised India's GDP projection to 6.7%. So previously, as per Goldman Sachs projection, it was 6.6% for the calendar year 2024, and now it has increased by 10 basis points. So as per the analysis at the Goldman Sachs, the core inflation, it is expected to increase to 4.5% in the second half of the current year 2024. And it has also changed the prediction of the cut in the interest rate. So it previously, if you see the Goldman Sachs, it had predicted that the RBI would reduce the interest rate in the quarter three of the current year 2024. But now it has changed and it is revised to quarter four. That is, it is expecting a rate cut in December 2024 of the MPC meeting. Now, the Goldman Sachs chairman and CEO is David M. Solomon. It is headquartered in New York City. RBI imposes monetary penalty on the ICICI Bank and Yes Bank. So on Yes Bank, it had imposed a penalty of rupees 1 crore for sanctioning term loans without proper due diligence. That is, it has not checked the viability and the bankability of the project without doing a proper due diligence. The bank had sanctioned the term loans, and due to that, the RBI had imposed a penalty of 1 crore. And it has also imposed a penalty of 91 lakhs on the Yes Bank because it had charged fees on the accounts with zero balance. So they are zero balance account, that is, they don't have to require to maintain any balance. On those type of accounts, they have charged fees, and also they have opened internal accounts in the customer names for unauthorized purpose such as parking funds, routing customer transactions. So due to this reason, 91 lakhs penalty has been imposed on Yes Bank Limited. Poonawalla Fincorp and IndusInd Bank jointly launched a co-branded credit card called Poonawalla Fincorp IndusInd Bank E-Lite Rupee Credit Card. Now, so if you see, Poonawalla Fincorp is an NBFC. So in this co-branding credit card, the Poonawalla Fincorp is only involved in the marketing and distribution of this credit card under a revenue sharing arrangement. It has also included a new program called Total Protect. So this Total Protect, it will cover unauthorized transactions. That is, it will provide insurance up to 48 hours after reporting loss or theft of the card. It will also provide counterfeit fraud, that is protection against misuse of stolen card details, and also an air accident insurance cover of up to 25 lakhs. The MD and CEO of IndusInd Bank is Sumant Kathpalia. It is headquartered in Mumbai and it was established in 1994. The government of India has announced 1 million immediate relief to a landslide hit Papua New Guinea. So the government has announced a 1 million to the country because it had faced a massive landslide. This is not the first time we are helping the country. We have also helped it in the previous times. That is, when an earthquake had occurred in 2018, and also during the volcanic eruptions in 2019 and 2023. Bank of Maharashtra introduces Mahakrishi Samruddhi Yojana to offer financial support for the food and agro-based industries. So if you see, individuals, proprietors, partnership, private companies, public limited companies, all these are eligible for the assistance under this Yojana. So this Yojana will extend loan facilities not only to the existing as well as to the new food and agro processing units under agriculture. So they will provide term loans, working capital, bank guarantee with a maximum loan amount of rupees up to rupees 100 crore will be provided under this Yojana. The repayment period of the term loan is up to 10 years, And the margin required is also quite low. That is, for term loans, a margin of minimum 10 to 25% is required. And for working capital, the margin minimum is 25%. For all accounts with aggregate exposure of about 25 lakhs, an internal credit rating is required. And for all loan accounts, the aggregate exposure is about 25 crores. Then the external credit rating is mandatory with a minimum credit risk rating to be BBB. So if the aggregate exposure is about 25 lakhs, then internal credit rating is required. And if all the loan account aggregate exposure is about 25 crores, then the external credit rating is required and the minimum rating should be BBB. That is triple B. The MD and CEO is Nidhu Saxena. It is headquartered in Pune and it was established in 1935. SBI Research Report. India's GDP growth likely to touch at 8%. So as per the SBI Research Report, India's GDP for the financial year 24, it is expected to reach 8%. And for the quarter 4 of the financial year 24, it is expected to grow at 7.4%. So as per the SBI's artificial neural network model, so it has stated that India's GDP growth will be 7.4% for the fourth quarter of the financial year 24. And also it has stated as per the RBI estimation of GDP, it will be 7.3% for quarter 4 financial year 24. And for quarter 1 financial year 25, it will be 7.5%. And for the financial year 25, it will be a 7% GDP growth. The main reason for this growth will be rural economy. So their growth has accelerated a lot, so which has increased to 75% in March 2024, compared to 56% in February and 60% in January. Apart from the rural economy, around 2,400 listed entities reported a top line growth of 9% in Q4 financial year 24. There are two lines. One is top line, another one is bottom line. Top line represents the revenue of the company and bottom line represents the profit of the company. So the top line growth in Q4 was 9% and the EBITDA increased by approximately 21%. But the profit after tax growth decreased from 42% to 12% in the last two quarters on a year-on-year basis. The global and as per the IMF estimates, the global headline inflation will decrease from 6.8% in 2023 to 5.9% in 2024 and to 4.5% in 2025. So as per the CRESL ratings, the bank credit growth is going to slip by 200 basis points, that is to 14% in financial year 25. So the domestic rating agency CRISIL Rating Limited, it has stated that the bank credit growth is to grow only by 14% in financial year 25 compared to 16% growth rate in financial year 24. So the various contributions from the various sectors are the corporate credit, which occupies around 45% of the bank credit. It is the largest segment and is expected to grow at 13%. Retail credit, the second largest segment, is expected to grow at 16%. And MSME, which contributes around 60% of the overall credit, it is expected to grow at 15%. And agriculture credit is linked to the monsoon trends. The MD of CRISIL Rating Limited is Gurupreet Chatwal. It is headquartered in Mumbai.
Thank you for watching the session. I hope you had enjoyed it. We're also available in Telegram under the name affairscloud_official. We also have an Instagram handle. Apart from this, you can contact us directly on 9677333862 regarding any courses that we offer or regarding any payment issues. You can contact directly on this number. Thank you.